Millions of years of evolution have led to this, but unfortunately, there's one thing that's a little bit off in the equation, and it's not something dangerous, it's not something freaky, but it is the perception of tinnitus. Day number 5 of Tinnitus Week 2024, and day number 5 is why there isn't a real cure for tinnitus yet. Yeah, in all these other days, we've discussed first video, my story with tinnitus, how I came to suffer from a deaf ear and hearing aid and tinnitus in the other one. Second video, we have discussed the mosquito bite and tinnitus, why the more you scratch, the more you itch. The third one, we talked a little bit about why avoiding tinnitus at all costs is a bad idea. Yesterday, we talked about tinnitus and hearing aids and why wearing hearing aids can be a good idea if you have an indication, and why wasting your money if you have not an indication for hearing aids is not such a great idea. And today we talk a little bit about why there isn't a real tinnitus cure yet, in the sense of that we have a simple pill or treatment that we can swallow or administer and then really get rid of tinnitus. And it's all got to do with the perception of tinnitus, or why we experience tinnitus, or in fact, why most people experience tinnitus. See, tinnitus is incredibly common, but 20%, sometimes up to 25%, depending on the country or region, of people experience tinnitus, meaning a phantom sound inside their ear or head that only they can hear, right? So it's something very, very normal. Most of you probably know it for the first time. You got it after a loud noise event, maybe a concert, and your ears were ringing. So literally, this is the same thing. And most of the time, you probably recovered from that temporary hearing loss. And let me tell you why. So the inner ear is incredibly complex. Let me say it in a few words. There is an inner ear, and in the inner ear, there are little hair cells that move in a fluid, so that in the eardrum, with the fluid inside and the little hair cells, when there's sound pressure, right, sound waves are pressure. So there's pressure from my speaking using air, compressed air going through my mouth and lips and then arriving here in the condensator and the microphone, and then you guys can hear it because it's decoded at the other side of the word. First it's encoded, digital signal, and so on and so forth, and then it's decoded and you guys hear what I'm saying. But in the end, it is sound pressure, so pressure traveling to your eardrum, making something vibrate. Inside there's some fluid and some little hair cells. They move a little bit, like if you would say like underwater plants. Yeah, same thing. And then that movement from outer to inner hair cells is translated into an electrical signal. That electrical signal travels up the auditory nerve into your auditory cortex, the part of the brain that puts it together as a sound, right? So basically as a puzzle piece, puts it together and says, okay, what's the electrical signal that's coming from the ear, and let's put it together as a sound interpretation. It's quite marvelous, actually, right? When you think about it, sense of vision, same thing. What you see is light traveling to your eye, and then in your eye, there's the light arriving at your eye, but actually where you see is inside the brain, right? Because the picture is then put together inside the brain. Your brain interprets what you see. Millions of years of evolution have led to this, but unfortunately, there's one thing that's a little bit off in the equation, and it's not something dangerous, it's not something freaky, but it is the perception of tinnitus. Let me tell you how it happens. So tinnitus is the perception of an absence of a sound when no real sound is present. That means that when we start losing our hearing ability, and everybody does, so if we're not young children anymore and we can't hear two frequencies, for example, maybe as a young person you used to hear a dog whistle and you can't hear that anymore, it's absolutely normal. Over the period of our life, our hearing ability naturally degenerates, right? That can have sometimes outside environmental impacts of loud noise exposure, sometimes work factors when you work in loud noise environments, sometimes if you're just as stupid as me, going to a lot of clubs without hearing protection in your teenage years. And all of these factors lead to the fact that some of these little hair cells, they don't move properly anymore, okay? So let's say it's a little bit like the underwater plant that sort of like loses and can't move properly anymore. And that doesn't mean, however, that there's still an electrical signal generated, because in the absence of that movement, the brain still thinks, oh, but there should be something coming, because there's other sound coming too, right? Because you always hear some kind of sounds. There's my stomach rumbling because I haven't had breakfast yet all morning. There is the radiator in the background. So there's always sound, right? But there's also, in this case, with the non-functioning hearing hair cells, an absence of input. And that absence of input is by the brain interpreted to say, wait, but there should be something, right? So that is the creation of tinnitus. So literally, it is literally just an electrical signal that is misinterpreted by your auditory cortex. So the part in your brain that says, well, there should be a sound, but there isn't. And then you hear whatever beeping or hissing or whatever it is, right? There are different forms. There's also pulsatile tinnitus, which then is more a form of maybe you hear your own heartbeat and stuff like that, right? Maybe because of tension in the neck and back, then you have somatic tinnitus. But most people experience this hearing loss based tinnitus that's based on the non-movement and absence of input that is then interpreted in your brain as tinnitus. And here lies the real and true difficulty of why there is not a real tinnitus cure yet. The real tinnitus cure yet doesn't exist because we can't yet reestablish the inner ear and the functioning of the hair cells. Now, there have been a few projects, some of you might know them, and you can Google them, that are working with restoring these inner hair cells. And we by now know from research that in some species that's possible. I think I remember correctly, I was at HLLA conference, the Hearing Loss Association of America conference in Minneapolis a few years back, and there was a big discussion from some very, very renowned professors about that these hearing hair cells can be regenerated in, for example, fish and baby chickens, and that now there are some trial runs even to have a genetically modified kind of agent that then travels to the inner ear of, for example, an ape or something like that. And then we have the regeneration of some of these hearing hair cells. And there seem to be preliminary studies that as soon as we improve the hearing ability, tinnitus, the perception of tinnitus might also go down, right? There's less activity, the brain has more information again, tinnitus might go down or even for some people completely vanish. But in and of itself, a real tinnitus cure is something incredibly complex. And no matter what all of these people out there might be promising you, it's very, very difficult to say it's a real tinnitus cure where you 100% get rid of all phantom sounds that you experience. So it is in the problem that we have a physical signal being translated into an electrical signal and then interpreted in the brain that is the difficulty. You can't simply modulate that process better. And the inner ear is incredibly complex. We talk about structures that are so small. These inner hair cells are nanometer small, right? Like you have to have specific microscopes to even see them. And there is a very, very big research process going on in how we can maybe restore the hearing ability. And of course, that would be the most favorable way to, for example, for me to also treat my hearing loss, right? To gain some hearing back. My tinnitus is not bothering me one bit, but it would be amazing for me to get my sense of hearing back and not having to wear this hearing aid, because a hearing aid is never as good as close natural hearing. Another reason for why it's a good idea to protect your hearing if you can. So it's incredibly complex, this topic, and I think I'm going to make another episode in the future about this and have some more renowned scientists also on the podcast that talk about this. But I want you to not despair, because the important part that you need to know is tinnitus is in 99% of all cases not dangerous. It's a benign body symptom that you experience from the absence of input due to the hearing loss that is absolutely naturally occurring in humans. Right? And when you see it this way, you can start relating to it in a different way. And what we have built is a habituation program, a program where we can teach you and your brain that you don't need to be upset and constantly looking for your tinnitus, so it can go into the background a little bit like the humming of your fridge when you read your newspaper in the morning. Does that bother you? Probably not. So if you're interested to find out more about that, then go to www.mytinnitus.club and sign up for a 14 days free trial. You can also read my free guide to tinnitus at tinnitus-guide.com. I hope this was insightful and useful and shed a little bit of light on why there isn't a real cure for tinnitus yet. And I'll see you in the next one tomorrow. The next one marks the end of Tinnitus Week 2024, the final video for Tinnitus Week 2024. I hope you found all of these videos helpful. I certainly did enjoy making them and would love to hear your feedback. And I'll see you tomorrow for the last video of Tinnitus Week 2024. Goodbye. All right, guys, I just wanted to give you a very short introduction here to our online Tinnitus Club. So as soon as you have signed up, and I'll show you in a minute how to easily do that, you are directed onto this very first page. It's a quick welcome video where I tell you a little bit more about this club and everything that we have in store for you. We have a challenge going on to help everyone building the right kind of habits towards being able to habituate to their tinnitus. You can see there's a lot of engagement. And down here, you will see the tinnitus courses. So when you go down here, you can find the beginner's course that's included in all of these subscriptions. You would go to www.mytinnitus.club and then you go to choose a plan, and then down here you will find all the different plans. So for example, if you want unlimited access to everything for 7 days to try everything out, then you can just get the 7-day plan for $9.99. Access to everything, enter your first name, last name, email and password, and you create your account. Quickly put your credit card data in. It's all safe and secure. This is handled by the platform and Stripe. So it's all safe and secure, or you can log in with Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Apple. For the other ones, we have 14-day free trials. So if you want to check those out, you get 14-day trials on any of these packages. Continue with Apple and then just agree to these terms and conditions, and then you're set to join our online Tinnitus Club.